Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, grace, mercy, and peace are yours from God our Heavenly Father, through His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We've just read the account of the Transfiguration. This is the only account we're aware of, the only time in Jesus' earthly ministry where anyone saw His full, or if only near full, divine glory revealed. It happened two other times in scriptures that we know of. Once to Moses on top Mount Sinai, and again to then Saul on his way to Damascus. Now, to be sure, there were other appearances that Jesus made, not that we know of in glory, and there were other appearances that may have been in glory in visions, but we're just not sure if that's comparing apples to apples or apples to oranges or not. We just don't know. But doesn't it cause you to wonder a little bit? I mean, why did Jesus do this? Why now? Why not after Easter? After the resurrection? Why to only these three? Why not to all 12? And we probably have a host of other questions that begin with the word why, for which we may not find answers. So perhaps the better question this morning, the one that we're going to address, is the one on the screen in front of you. It's that familiar Lutheran question, what does this mean? And perhaps it was good for Jesus to be encouraged by Moses and Elijah, the prophets of old, through whom He had prophesied His impending suffering, death, and resurrection. But if the Transfiguration were only for the benefit of Jesus, then admittedly He could have gone to a mountain any time and been transfigured, and He wouldn't have had to take anybody with Him. And if He wanted us to know, He could just tell us. And so it's pretty certain that Jesus went up to the mountain to be transfigured, not for His benefit, but for the benefit of the three men He took with them. They needed the Transfiguration. Jesus revealed Himself as God. Two of these men, anyway, were going to give their lives confessing Christ, refusing to deny any of the things that they had said happened. Two of those men would also be inspired by God's Spirit to write books that are still included in our New Testament Bible. And since these men were to receive some benefit from the Transfiguration, and because they've passed it on to us through the other evangelists and apostles, it must be of some benefit and blessing to you and to me still 2,000 years later. So let's ask that question. What does this mean? What did it mean for Peter, James, and John? And what does it mean still today for us? We'll do that by considering the aspects of the Transfiguration. First of all, there's just the fact that Jesus walked up to that mountain, and when they got to the top, the Bible tells us He was just transfigured. He changed. Suddenly, He was glorified. A glory of His divine nature started radiating through the human nature which He had allowed to cover it up to that point. This wasn't a reflected glory like that of the angels. This was His glory as God radiating from within Him and shining out. And it affected everything that he was, His skin, his robes even. St. Mark tells us they were so white, they had nothing to compare it to. It was whiter than anyone could have bleached them. So bright was that dazzling glory. What does that mean? What did that mean for those three? It it meant that this friend they had been traveling with and this teacher and rabbi from whom they had been learning had to be more than just a friend and a rabbi, just another great prophet. He absolutely had to be God. Then the Bible tells us that in that very same moment, Elijah appears and Moses with him. How immediately they recognized them as Elijah and Moses, I'm not certain. It could be just from the conversations that Moses and Elijah were having with Jesus, but it was Moses and it was Elijah. Moses, who had been dead for now about 1,500 years and whom God had buried. And then there's Elijah. We just read about him. He's the one who 900 years before this time had been taken up to heaven in a whirlwind, never to face death. And nevertheless, there they are, the two of them, standing there, glorified, alive in body and soul, having a conversation with Jesus. And one of the other apostles, or the gospel writers, relates to us that they spoke about Jesus coming, suffering, death, and resurrection. Of course, why wouldn't they? That's what Moses and Elijah had prophesied. That's why he was the great prophet to come. That's why the Messiah was coming into the world. It doesn't surprise us that that's what they would talk about. But what was the presence of those apostles there to benefit? How was that to benefit the disciples who then were also there? Well, didn't it also assure them that this Jesus, their friend, now their God, was in fact the Messiah, the one prophesied by the prophets? Absolutely. But think about what the very presence of Moses and Elijah communicated to them. It was a bit of a foreshadowing, wasn't it? It was evident then that because these who had long passed were now alive again, glorified, and on that mountain talking with Jesus without veils on their faces, that Jesus' victory over sin and Satan and hell and death was already in God's eternal sight an accomplished fact. And that just as Moses and Elijah would stand there in glory with Jesus face to face in unveiled glory, so one day they would also. And finally, St. Mark tells us that as that conversation, we don't know how long it took, but at the end of that conversation, this cloud settled on the mountain. I don't know if it was a normal kind of cloud like we would experience, or if it was some special cloud that was veiling to some degree God's glory. But Mark tells us it terrified them all over again. And then they heard that voice, that unmistakable voice, even though if you've never heard it before, you'd never mistake it, the voice of God the Father, who declared for all the world, for those three to hear, "This one, this Jesus, is my Son, whom I love." The Father was once again affirming this human mind-blowing concept of the relationship between the Father and Son. And you could include the Holy Spirit in this, in the one being of our God. But then he's also affirming Jesus' righteousness. "Whom I love." He loved him, sure, from eternity, because he is in that unique relationship in the one God. But he still loved him because he had continued to live a righteous life ever since his baptism, when the Father had declared the same thing. But then the Father had a word for them. Listen to him. Not just, you know, hear the words he's saying, but listen, pay attention. Do what he tells you to do. Listen to him. Then it tells us that as soon as he had finished speaking, the cloud lifted, and the only person standing up there was Jesus, who had again covered up his divinity with his humanity. He had hidden it, and they made their way back down the mountain. And Jesus had a word for them. Don't tell anybody until after the resurrection. And they didn't. They didn't blab this to anyone, as far as we know, until after the resurrection. But one thing they were puzzled about, one of the gospel writers tells us that they did wonder among themselves what he meant by resurrection. And given everything they had just witnessed, I guess that would not surprise us, would it? That was a lot to take in, wasn't it? Fantastic. A wonderful, so wonderful for them to take in. Peter is absolutely right. It is good for us to be here, Lord. Yes, it is. In fact, Jesus wanted them to be there. That's why he had graciously chosen them and brought them up to the mountain with him. He wanted them to see his glory. He wanted them to see Moses and Elijah. He wanted them to hear the Father's voice. That was all for their benefit, for their comfort, for their hope. But Peter was wrong about the next thing he said. Let's stay here. Let's stay on this mountain and we'll build 3 shabby earthly dwellings for you. Now that was kind of silly, and the gospel writers all admit Peter, they were all terrified and they didn't know what to say. They're just throwing things out there. But that would have been a very bad idea, because that would have thwarted the very purpose for which Jesus had been sent into the world, the very plans that Moses and Elijah had encouraged him to carry out. And it would have meant that not only would Moses and Elijah not been able to have been on that mountain with him, it would have meant Peter, James, and John could never have been in glory with Jesus. So yeah, it's good for them that they were there, but it wasn't good for them to stay. It was necessary for them to go back down the mountain. Perhaps you've already begun to pick up on the blessings that Jesus intended for his 3 disciples on top of the Mount of Transfiguration. It confirmed for them Jesus' nature, divine nature, as the Son of God. It confirmed that he was also the Messiah, their Savior, the one promised by the prophets. It assured them that Jesus had come and would overcome in his struggle against the devil and death and hell, that he would be victorious, that sins, in fact, would be washed away. It also then assured them, it provided them the sure hope that they too, like Moses, like Elijah, and all believers, would one day enjoy the same glorified bodies and unveiled vision of Jesus in glory. But what are the benefits of the transfiguration for you? What does the transfiguration mean for you? We haven't seen Jesus transfigured into glory, have we? We didn't see Moses and Elijah. We haven't heard the voice of the Father in the cloud. For that matter, we haven't seen or heard any of the things that are recorded for us in our Bibles. We are simply recipients of these eyewitness accounts. And were it up to us in our sinful human natures, we would remain forever inclined to disbelieve, distrust, and to deny all of it. Because according to our sinful human way of thinking, all of these things are far too wonderful, far too fantastic for any of it to be anything but false. And yet, when we read Scripture, we notice there's a remarkable consistency. A consistency from Genesis to Revelation. It proclaims one message of sin and grace and faith and works, and it proclaims one Savior and one way of salvation. that of through faith in Jesus alone. And somehow, those words then convince us. Somehow, those words convince us that what they say is actually true, that it happened, and it has meaning for us. But how do they do that? How can they go against what we were thinking in our minds and believing in our hearts? Brothers and sisters, behold the power of your God. The Word of God, the Bible, is the power of God and His Spirit. And through that Word, the Spirit convinces you against your human nature that what He's telling you is the truth, and that those truths then mean something for you. And he tells you what they mean, too. So that through the Word, by faith, you really have seen Jesus glorified. You really have seen Moses and Elijah. You have heard the voice of God. St. Peter goes on to write in his letter, urging us, pleading with us to trust him as an eyewitness, to trust the eyewitness accounts, to trust the scriptures and what's said in them. Because, he says, they are the very words of God who does not lie to us. And that is what this account then pleads us to do. Through this account, God is calling us first again to listen to Jesus. Listen to him. But what does Jesus do? He's calling us then also to trust him. Put your trust in Jesus. Trust that he is the Messiah, the one promised through the Old Testament prophets. Trust that this Jesus with hidden glory entered into the world because he loves you. Trust that this Jesus then descended the Mount of Transfiguration so that he could ascend that little hill known as Calvary with your sin and guilt in tow. In fact, with the sin and guilt of the world credited to him but taken away from us. Trust that Jesus bled and suffered all that sin away under the fury of God, an eternal suffering for every single countless sin. But then also trust, as the Mount of Transfiguration reveals to us, that Jesus would also rise from the dead, proclaiming victory even over death itself. He did all of this because he loves you, and through it he has saved you. So what does that then mean? Well, trust what it means. It means that just like Moses and Elijah stood glorified on that mountain, body and soul in unveiled glory, talking with Jesus, so one day you will too. One day Jesus will raise you, and he will glorify you body and soul, and you will stand before him in unveiled glory. Jesus will raise you, and he will glorify you also. As these events certainly gave hope and comfort to the disciples in the bitter days, and even in the sweet days, and the confusion of his suffering, death, and resurrection, so Jesus has provided you with the same hope and the same comfort he gave to them. Hope and comfort for you on your bitter days, as well as on your sweet days, even on days when you're still living in confusion. Keep reminding yourself, remembering your Lord's transfiguration. Again, not as I said earlier, not as facts, simply that you just remember it happened like you remember the fall of the Alamo. But remember the transfiguration of your Lord so that you can rely on the promises that it's making to you. The very promises we've just recalled. Rely on those promises that your Jesus loves you and that he came into this world to share time with you, to share a human body, to be your Savior. Rely on the promise that just as he did for Moses and Elijah, so he is going to raise and glorify you. And you will be with him in glory, in unveiled glory. And when we finally arrive on that day, we will be able to say with Peter, Lord, it is best for us to be here with you. Thank you for building this place where we can spend eternity with you forever free from sin and guilt, the power of the devil, from death, forever free from fear and every evil. Yes, thousand thanks shall be, dearest Jesus, unto thee. Amen.